The day of the Lord. Peter has another important message for us this week.
Millennials have passed since God has surrendered this world in the rulership of someone who had the pretense of being God. The facts, though, and the data show that it has been a disastrous failure and that this king has to be dethroned. Did you know about that? Is Peter's question in this lesson. And when knowing that, how do you live your lives? Is his second question. Because he says, the day of the Lord is coming like a thief.
Regarding the second coming, it's not so much knowing about it, but about how we see it. The author makes an interesting point at the beginning that is kind of tied to the sense of accountability. If we don't have to be accountable to anyone, then our life philosophy and some of our choices may be different. But if at the end there is judgment, justice, accountability, the perspective is very different. So Peter starts chapter 3 pointing to the importance of the message that he is writing about and also pointing to the authority from which he is doing it. He puts the message from the prophets and the apostles on one side, pointing to their authority and commission from God, and on the other side, there are some other people or messengers.
Last week, Peter warned us, or his entrusted church, that there will be false teachers. This week, he has a different warning. He's afraid that a group of scoffers in the church will challenge the long-standing belief that Jesus will come a second time back on earth. In contrast to the group of the false teachers, who acted secretly to achieve their agenda, the group of the scoffers, they're acting out in the open, arrogantly undermining the most hopeful belief of Christ's followers. And the challenge is in their question, where is the promise of his coming? Everything goes on as it has been since the beginning of creation. However, these two groups have one thing in common. According to Peter, both were walking according to their own lusts. So the consequences for the community of faith could be detrimental, as we saw in the last lesson.
The days of Peter were different, and I don't know why this Peter were making fun of the second coming, but today I know that there may be different reasons. Some may be just tired of waiting. Others can be going through tough time and feel discouraged. Some can be angry. They are parents that believe so strong that an end is near that they neglected their children and their future. They have legitimate reasons to be angry. But the fact is that God has always been faithful. People were making fun of the warning about the flood, and it cost them dearly.
So, should we worry that Jesus is still not here as he promised to be back? Peter provides a worth noticing answer when he says that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years is like a day. It's a concept that we don't understand, so we have to be careful when we make judgments about time. So at the end, we can't say that God is late or God has delayed. When it comes to things that are out of this realm, we can only exercise faith. And unfortunately, our feelings and our emotions, they can sway us away from our beliefs and our good conscience. This is when we can get easily discouraged. And Peter wants to spare us this pain.
It's important to acknowledge our limited understanding about divine things and about the extent and implications of the controversy between God and evil. It's also important to realize that the main focus now is on salvation. Jesus' sacrifice guaranteed it. Our salvation is won. But now it's about people, about choices, about decisions, about taking a stand, and about testifying for the difference that God can make in us. Jesus is coming. There is no doubt about it. The question is different.
So what? What if I know that Jesus is coming back again? So what? Peter raises the question. Does it make a difference, really, that I know about this big event? It used to matter a lot when I found Jesus and when I familiarized for the first time myself with the Bible. but it has, frankly, it has cooled down since, and somehow plays a much smaller role in my mind, in my thinking. There are many other factors in life that occupy my mind, and very little time left to rekindle this fire coming from the knowledge of the second coming of my Savior.
Hey, Peter, did you really think that in 2017 we'll still be talking about this in future tense? How about you, Miller, Bates, the Whites? I'm sure that they would all have said, no, my friend. But keep your head up. Look around. It's coming. But what do you think that you should do? Maybe like Desmond Doss, our mind should be on God. Please, help me to save one more. One more, God, one more! Anything else will put us on the side of the scoffers.
At the end, after reading the lesson, I'm thinking about the second coming right now. And I'm facing two choices. The first one, nicely to push it back on the shelf and forget about it. The second one is a choice for a change, a drastic one, or probably step by step if things are complicated. The second choice for a change is a brave one, but it's a life refreshing. So after reading this lesson, take a minute for yourself and consider your choices.
Mm-hmm. It does matter how we live our lives. It does matter how we see the future. Jesus is coming soon. Join us next week to wrap up this quarter with major themes from 1 and 2 Peter.